since the sudden destruction of Michael Spinks.
And he's down again, and in serious trouble. A right hand right on the chin.
And 5 months since a less scintillating knockout of Frank Bruno.
And Bruno tries to punch back.
Carl the Truth Williams faces the controlled fury and violence of boxing's most feared champion, Mike Tyson. It's taken just a little bit more than a year for the heavyweight champion of the world to return to this small city on the southern crest of New Jersey. We are live, Convention Center in Atlantic City, New Jersey, as HBO's Forge presents World Championship Boxing. Tonight, undisputed heavyweight champion Mike Tyson defends that title against the number one ranked contender of the International Boxing Federation, Carl the Truth Williams. Fight is scheduled for 12 rounds. It was June 27, 1988, when Mike Tyson settled once and for all the question of who was the real heavyweight champion. In this arena, Tyson made short order of Michael Spinks in 91 seconds of calculated aggression. His personal life, in disarray then, is no less tumultuous now. His every move outside the ring is a topic of conversation on television talk shows, in magazines, in neighborhood bookstores, none of which has seemed to affect his ability here in the ring. Tonight, another test for the 23-year-old heavyweight fighting machine. And hello again, I'm Jim Lampley. We welcome you back to HBO's continuing chronicle of Mike Tyson's path through heavyweight boxing history. Many of his fights, including this one, now regarded by the public as competitive formalities. For more on that, our returning HBO boxing expert, back from his brief vacation and his dust up with Thomas Hearns, Sugar Ray Leonard. And Sugar Ray, Mike is to a certain degree a victim of his own success. He knocks out Frank Bruno in 5 rounds and is criticized by most in boxing for what was seen as a lackluster performance. Is there validity to the idea of criticizing Mike for what he did against Bruno?
Well, I'll tell you one thing about it, Jim. It's just reality because of Mike Tyson's dominance of the heavyweight division. Whenever he steps into the ring, especially when he annihilated Michael Spinks in 1 round, if it goes past 2 or 3 rounds, people say, look, it's a lackluster performance. And with Bruno, Bruno's a big heavyweight and gave him problems because of the height advantage. But I think that Mike Tyson, for the most part, fought a very impressive fight.
So what's at stake now for Mike as he goes against another opponent who is regarded by most of having no chance whatsoever of staying with him?
Well, a lot of times, because it's a no-win situation, that has a tendency to affect one's fighter's performance. But I think Mike Tyson, with his intensity and tenacity, will do pretty well. But then again, we're fighting a taller guy, Mike Tyson is, in Carl Williams.
Indeed, 6'5" tall, 6'4", man with a 14-inch reach advantage and a highly competent jab. Nevertheless, an overwhelming underdog in the fight. For more on that, our HBO boxing analyst, Larry Merchant. Larry, the obvious question when a man is a 12-, 15-, 17-to-1 betting underdog, does Carl Williams have any realistic chance against Mike Tyson?
Well, as the saying goes, slim and none, and in this case, I'm not even sure Slim came to town. But let's face it, the reason we watch Mike Tyson fights is not for sterling competition. It's for the sheer drama of Mike Tyson, his talent and his power, and perhaps out of some morbid curiosity or hope for the other guy. How will he handle himself in the storm? Will he be brave? Carl Williams says that he's going into the lion's den to take the meat out of the lion's mouth. He says he's going to cut open Tyson like a can of peaches. That takes care of the entree and of the dessert, but unfortunately for him, few opponents of Tyson ever get past the appetizer.
Indeed, 36 times Tyson has fought, 32 times he's won by knockout, 21 of those within the first 2 rounds of the fight. He is, as always tonight, an overwhelming favorite to win. But the more Mike stays the same, the more the world around him changes. Now he enters the ring for the second time with a third distinct incarnation of his entourage, now called Team Tyson. now a well-known story. 10 years ago in Catskill, New York, a trainer and his 13-year-old fighter envisioned a future which would change boxing history.
I don't know if it's born to be a champion, but I have that in mind, but I'm at least born to be a fighter.
Several years later, the aging trainer selected a former pupil as his disciple. Along with a pair of co-managers, they formed a unit, the first Team Tyson. Following their successful formula, Mike Tyson obtained 3 heavyweight crowns, but he would eventually lose his 2 dearest friends. Trainer Cus D'Amato passed away in 1985. Manager Jim Jacobs died in 1988. In the following months, the team would grow, and when Tyson fought Michael Spinks, it was larger than ever before. Now in the picture were a wife, a mother-in-law, promoter, and advisor. The biggest changes were still to follow. Bring out the old, bring in the new might as well have been the theme for the Tyson-Bruno fight. As of last February, Robin Givens, Ruth Roper, Donald Trump, assistant manager Steve Lott, and trainer Kevin Rooney had all departed. Besides Tyson, estranged manager Bill Caton was the only original member to remain. Added now were Rory Holloway, John Horn, Aaron Snowell, Jay Bright, and Carl King. They named themselves Team Tyson and are based at Don King's training camp in Orwell, Ohio.
Team Tyson is a team which, you know, I organize. I mean, out of my connections with the people, I put aside my life and I found out, A and B, who's been the most trustworthy, and I decided I'm gonna develop my own organization.
Few would now question that the fighter, Mike Tyson, is the boss of this organization and that its members are there to please him.
Michael's like my brother, and I would do anything for Michael.
Whenever he call on me, I'm there.
The most important thing is for Mike to be happy. It doesn't matter how much we suffer.
But they like their jobs, and each ecstatically describes the benefits of this organization.
Team Tyson provide Mike with the necessary things of having a family and having friends that you can trust, relate to, and identify with.
Everybody works together here as a big family.
The key word here is family. But while Team Tyson undoubtedly enjoys its unity, there are the critics who have their doubts.
Well, I've read things about, they have an amateur team and they don't know what they're doing and this and that.
Two of Mike's oldest friends are assistant manager Rory Holloway and camp coordinator John Horn. Like most new employees, both will admit that they have much to learn.
I'm learning as I go along, but Mike knows I have a good head on my shoulder.
Don King is our teacher. You know what I mean? I don't know everything there is to know about boxing, but what I don't know, I'm learning from Don King, who's the best.
Some contend that it is indeed Don King who is running this organization and that he has too much influence over the champion.
What they try to do is to divide us and make us feel like one is against the other, one is trying to claim something from the other. What I do is tell him what, in my judgment, whether I think something is right for him or whether it's wrong for him, but I allow him the courtesy and the right to make the decision as to whether you want to pursue that course of action or not.
But the fiercest criticism is directed at the trainers, Jay Bright and Aaron Snowell. Boxing experts question their qualifications to train the heavyweight champion of the world. Former fighter, Bright is another who learned to box under Cus D'Amato. His greatest claim was the day he sparred with Muhammad Ali. Last February, Bright was brought in as a replacement to the champion's former trainer, Kevin Rooney.
Champ, 772.
I feel I'm very qualified to train heavyweight champion of the world. I've been around Cus, and I understand Michael. I understand the ideology behind Cus, and I understand the style very, very well.
Aaron Snowell's credentials include having trained former heavyweight champion Tim Witherspoon and present junior middleweight champ Julian Jackson. He was loath to accept any blame for Tyson's lackluster performance against Frank Bruno.
You have to understand that he was underneath a lot of stress and a lot of things were happening in his life. And for him to go in and do the job that he did, I think it's excellent. It's a compliment to Mike.
The questions and criticisms are likely to continue. But as long as Mike Tyson keeps winning, this team will probably stay together. For now, they remain an outward portrait of happiness. All for one, and one for all. And now we bring you back live to the convention center in Atlantic City, where there were rumors of ticket-selling trouble, but almost all seats are now filled with minutes to go before fight time. The 12-round World Heavyweight Championship bout coming up between undisputed three-belt world champion Mike Tyson and Carl Williams, the challenger who calls himself The Truth. Of course, the truth about Mike Tyson has proven elusive enough and intriguing enough to have spawned a storm of videotape and a small book publishing boom. Now here with his own observations about Tyson truth is our own in-house Diogenes, Larry Merchant.
Judging from those scenes of domestic tranquility we just saw, Mike Tyson is still searching for affection and family to go with his fame and fortune. From Brooklyn to Catskill to Hollywood to Midtown Manhattan to New Jersey and now to Orwell, Ohio. After the turmoil of last year, he has surrounded himself with admirers who make him feel good, which surely a 23-year-old king should be able to feel. Whether they're good for him as a fighter or as a businessman will be decided in the future. Right now, some of them are spending their time defending him from the enemy, such as the authors of those books that have been coming out, which they regard as too revealing. I've read some of those books, and Jose Torres' Fire and Fear has a lot of interesting anecdotes that remind me, anyway, how it's so easy to forget that you can run from your past, but you cannot hide from him. That the rough, hostile edges that have made Mike Tyson the fighter he is have also led to those public embarrassments in politer society. Tonight he's fighting another fighter who has arisen from those kinds of mean circumstances he did. He has smoother edges, but he hasn't been as successful.
For most, the streets of South Jamaica, Queens are no place to grow up, let alone in which to develop into a championship athlete. They call this man-forsaken place Crack Alley, and only a few, like Carl Williams, have escaped.
Yeah, I used to tell you to come run with me, but you was into one thing and I was into another.
Right.
That's basically what I'm saying. You was into one thing and I was into another. You know, there's two roads in life that you can go down. There's that straight one, that's the hardest road you can go down. And then there's that other one, this short road.
For the first 19 years of his life, Carl Williams took the short road. He flirted with trouble and played basketball day and night. Only his grandmother was around to rein him in. But as Carl matured, he grew frustrated with this lifestyle and out of anger, began hitting a heavy bag.
People used to say, you got something, you got something. I couldn't see it at that particular time. Whatever I had, it to me, it wasn't there. You know, it wasn't until my grandmother died that I really start thinking seriously about doing this.
At an age when most would-be professional fighters are experienced amateurs, Williams was just beginning. He walked 6 miles to the gym each day, out of hell and into a brave new world.
Whatever I was doing at that particular time, years and years ago, you know, I gave it up to become a boxer with no hopes, no aspirations or anything, no future really, but just a lot of hard work and determination.
Fighting out of the tiny O'Connell Park gym, Carl Williams entered the Golden Gloves with just a couple of amateur fights under his belt. Miraculously, he won a title.
Here was this big hulking guy with a piston for a left jab, and he immediately caught my eye. And for a guy that age to start that old and do what he did is certainly an accomplishment.
Flushed with success, Carl moved to suburban White Plains to get further boxing instruction. It was a Spartan existence at first, with Williams living alone in this motel, far enough away from his city friends and city temptations.
This is obviously a different environment, and I think in order for me to be successful, I had to move here to get away from some of my friends and try to more or less concentrate on, you know, being a professional fighter.
In White Plains, Carl developed rapidly as a fighter, gaining valuable ring experience he had missed as a teenager. One sparring partner came down from this gym in Catskill, New York, to spar with Williams, a 17-year-old named Mike Tyson. Memories differ as to what happened.
He jumped on me that particular day, gave me a bloody nose and everything. You know, I was a little, he shook me up because I was a professional with 7-8 fights. And I was saying to myself, oh my God, how can I let this amateur come in the gym and do this to me? So I got very angry that night. I went home and thought about it. And the very next day, I came in the gym with a different attitude towards him. I went into the ring and I busted him up.
Well, he sparred me when I was 14, 15 years old, and he couldn't kill me then. And now I'm 5 times, 10 times the fighter now.
He hit Mike a good right hand one day, but I can never say he never had Mike hurt. I never had to yank Mike out of it. I never had to cut it short, and we never invited back.
I think if they continued to bring him down here, Carl would have just totally destroyed the kid's confidence.
Either way, Williams advanced onward, meeting Larry Holmes for the title after just 16 pro fights. After dazzling the champ with his style, Carl lost a hotly disputed decision, but left the ring with high hopes and a promising future. The path down, though, was just as sudden. After this devastating knockout at the hands of Mike Weaver, it took Carl Williams 16 months to climb back into the ring.
Everybody loves a winner, but I was led to believe that the guys that were with me were a little better than the guys that I had heard about, but I guess I was wrong.
For his comeback, Carl asked longtime lawyer Ira Leibovitz to become his manager. Then Williams squeaked by Trevor Burbick, which thrust him into his mandatory title shot tonight as the IBF's number one contender. You can say the road Carl Williams has endured to reach Mike Tyson is a small miracle in life. From Carl's crack alley home to his boxing successes and failures, he has shown a tenacity with which few in his position have been blessed.
This is definitely a vindication for me, and I will not be denied. Not tonight or any other night. It's been too hard a road for me.
And now the long road to Mike Tyson reaches its end as Carl Williams enters the ring for his second heavyweight title challenge, the first of which came 4 years ago against Larry Holmes, a fight in which he gave a terrific account of himself. And what are those sparring sessions with Tyson? Well, there are videotapes of what took place 6 years ago, and we're going to show you some action from one session which took place August 1, 1983, at a time when Mike Tyson was a 17-year-old amateur and Carl "The Truth" Williams was a 23-year-old professional with 11 bouts under his belt. In most of the videotape footage we've seen from those sparring sessions, Williams was able to control Tyson with his jab and occasionally landed right crosses, which seemed to bother the young amateur. But you also saw the beginnings of the peekaboo style that Tyson exhibited with Customato, the legendary trainer, always looking on from a close distance. It's a different Carl Williams tonight. It's of course a different Mike Tyson whom he will be facing. And there is Carl Williams' record, 22 wins, the losses to Mike Weaver and Larry Holmes, 17 knockouts, as there is some punching power behind the best of Carl Williams' weapons, that straight, stiff, quick left jab. Williams really earned this shot as much as anything with his decision victory a year ago here over Trevor Burbick on the undercard of Tyson Spinks. And that's one of the bouts that boxing critics used to downgrade his chances tonight. He did not look terrific against Burbick.
I think we have to assume that he'll be the best he can be tonight if we can remember that he came up very big in his other big event. And maybe that means he'll give us more of a fight than we expect. We just have to assume that. He is in excellent condition.
And there comes the champion entering the ring for his 37th professional fight. 9-0 so far in heavyweight championship fights. A victory tonight would tie him with Joe Frazier for fifth on the all-time list in that category. Directly in front of Tyson was Aaron Snowell. He's now stepped ahead of a security guard. Jay Bright is the man just behind Tyson's shoulders now as he prepares to step up into the ring, whipping the ripped towel off over his head Of course, the gladiator look remains intact. Black shoes, no socks, black trunks, Mike Tyson.
You know, it is a sign of the importance that boxing has to Mike Tyson, that no matter what goes on around him, he's ready to fight.
As he has been 36 times with 32 knockouts so far. Quickly now, and focusing on the beginnings of Carl Williams' strategy, which has to be the left jab, Ray Leonard's tip of the night.
Well, the left jab speaks for itself. That's the key punch for Carl Williams, to keep that left jab in Tyson's face, keep him off balance, but most importantly, snap it and not bring it down too fast, because what's going to happen, Tyson should counter that left jab. Now, once the fight becomes an inside fight, in fact, I believe that's going to be the case because Tyson's style's getting inside, their right uppercut. That punch may accommodate Tyson's style, but in doing so, Williams better keep both hands up, because Tyson throws an onslaught of punches each and every time, each and every opportunity. Now, Jim, this is my favorite combination. I call it the Tyson combo. It's a right hand to the liver section, then to the chin. And most of the times that Tyson catches his opponent with this particular punch, it's over. Here we see him, a good shot of him, right up to the chin. If Williams get against the corner or the ropes, look for this particular combination to take place. With taller opponents, Tyson has a tendency to launch in because of the height and reach advantage. But here, he may find the same thing with the taller Williams.
Tail of the tape, and you can see the big disparity in reach. Carl Williams with a 14-inch advantage there at 219 and a quarter for Tyson and 218 for Williams. Both fighters appear to be in superb physical condition. Rules for the bout, combination, and before we look at rules, we'll look at the punch stat computations. Larry Merchant.
And here is our statistical profile of the activity of the fighters, which show in the fights that we examined remarkable similarities in the number of punches thrown and landed per round by Tyson Williams. But of course, there are different kinds of punches. Tyson throws the heavier stuff. Williams throws a majority of jabs.
And you see the 28 jabs per round Williams threw against Holmes. That is when he looked most effective. Rules for the fight, a combination of WBA and New Jersey rules. Most significant, the three knockdown rule, rarely in effect for championship fights, is in effect tonight. It victimized Carl Williams in his fight against Mike Weaver. Now we go to the ring announcer, Michael Buffer, for pre-fight introduction.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Atlantic City's Convention Hall by way of Donald Trump's Trump Plaza Hotel and Casino on the boardwalk here in Atlantic City, New Jersey. Tonight, Don King Productions and the Trump Plaza present the World Heavyweight Championship. This bout is approved and sanctioned by the New Jersey State Athletic Control Board. Larry Hazard, Sr., Commissioner, Deputy Commissioner Lawrence Wallace, and the chairman is Jerry Gormley. The bout is governed by the rules and regulations of the World Boxing Association, represented by Dr. Elias Cordova and James J. Biggs. It is also sanctioned by the International Boxing Federation, President Robert W. Lee, and the World Boxing Council, President Jose Suleiman. The three judges selected by the New Jersey State Athletic Control Board for this bout are Rocky Castellani, Chuck Giampa, and Richard F. Murray. Chief physician at ringside, Dr. Frank B. Doggett. Also in attendance, Dr. Eric Wormser and Dr. Charles Wilson. The timekeeper for the bout is Roosevelt Gilbert, and counting for the knockdown seconds, Steve Smoger. And now before we get started, I would like to introduce the gentleman in the ring at this time, a man who's responsible for bringing over 20 championship bouts to Atlantic City over the last 2 years. In addition to being the world's most famous entrepreneur, he is a best-selling author and our host this evening, Mr. Donald Trump. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the Trump Plaza Hotel and Casino in Atlantic City, New Jersey, let's get ready to rumble! 12 rounds of boxing for the undisputed heavyweight championship of the world. The referee for this bout is Randy Newman. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the white trunks with red trim, he weighs an even 218 pounds from Absecon, New Jersey. His professional record, 22 victories against only 2 defeats. 17 knockouts to his credit, and 14 of those 17 KOs within five rounds or less. Ladies and gentlemen, the number one heavyweight challenger in the world today, Carl the Truth Williams. And his opponent fighting out of the red corner, wearing the solid black trunks and weighing in at 219 and one quarter pounds from Catskill, New York. His professional record is unblemished with 36 consecutive victories, 32 knockouts, 28 KOs in five rounds or less, and 16 in the first round alone. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the undisputed, the undefeated heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson.
Number two, obey my commands. I'll shake hands and come out of the belt.
Keep in mind that Mike Williams has a tendency to get hit by left hooks. Carl Williams. I can think of better tendencies that a fighter should have who's going out to face Mike Tyson.
Indeed, Carl Williams has been floored seven times in his career. Twice by James Quick Tillis, twice by Jesse Ferguson, three times by Mike Weaver, and in every instance, the decisive blow was a left hook. The people in Williams' corner are sincerely worried about what he does in the first 30 seconds against the Tyson onslaught. And it would appear that the strategy to begin with is to hold, and referee Randy Newman says, we're not going to start that way.
This is somewhat of a reunion here because both men are just throwing punches. In fact, Williams here has selected to fight Tyson inside. He claimed the other day that if Tyson throws any unnecessary punches, illegal punches, he will accommodate him and throw the same punches back.
Well, Frank Bruno felt the sting of Tyson's elbow several times, as other opponents have complained that they have felt it as well.
Because Williams' left jab is so strong, that should help him as long as he keep that right hand up and watch Tyson's left hook, which is a powerful punch.
That's it. Let him go. All right, that's it. I'm here. Let him go. Get back.
Tyson Spinks. A minute 32 instead of a minute 31. It was, as you started to point out again, Larry, a left hook.
Williams was very unhappy at the end of that.
I saw you couldn't answer.
Randy Newman, the referee, asked him a question. Obviously about how he felt or what his name was or where he was. And apparently he got the wrong answer because he stopped the fight immediately. I didn't see any reason to stop the fight. And I'm curious to see what that answer was, and I'm going into the ring to see if I can find out.
Good luck, Larry.
A minute 33, Larry. It was 2 seconds longer than the Spinks fight. The unofficial demarcation of the knockout comes at 1:33 of the first round. And you can see a disgusted Carl Williams who thinks that he should have been allowed to continue. And Ray, I've got to agree with Larry. It was a fairly peremptory stoppage.
Well, the way I judge it, because he appeared to be okay, but then again, the referee is closer to the pitcher than we are.
What was that question likely to be?
Where are you? What day is this? And here we see the left hook that put Williams down. Williams had dropped that right hand, and I indicated earlier that the jab would be the key, but in throwing the left jab, he must also keep that right hand up and pow. There's that left hook.
And you saw Mike pivot upward with both feet planted and turn the hips into the punch. This is where the power comes from.
The reason people fear Mike Tyson because he's one of the few, if not the only man, that can knock you out in the heavyweight division with one punch.
Here's another look at the devastating left hook.
And what Tyson does here, he bobs and weaves, gets under that jab and counters with a beautiful left hook.
Perfectly timed as Williams was dropping the right hand, just as you said he did after throwing the jab.
Well, what happened for Williams, the fact that his left jab was working, and he felt very comfortable.
That was a look back at the conversation between Randy Newman and Carl Williams, which led to the stoppage.
Mike Tyson, as usual, awesome.
I'm reminded of a night in the Meadowlands in New Jersey when a referee stopped a bout between Mike Rossman and Victor Galindez. After a similar conversation, Rossman, the victim of the knockout, he chased the ref across the ring yelling, "What was the right answer?"
All right, I'm with Randy Newman, the referee of the fight. Obviously, the people in and out of the ring are unhappy that the fight was stopped. Randy, why did you stop the fight?
When he got up at 8, he was wobbly. He wasn't standing up. He was leaning against the ropes. I asked him a question, a very simple question. How do you feel? Not for the answer, but to see how he responded. His eyes were blank. His expression was blank. He had no answer.
Is there any chance that he misunderstood what you wanted him to respond to?
I don't think so. Let me tell you why. He's had a lot of professional fights and a lot of amateur fights. When a fighter is knocked down, and I had 38 fights, when a fighter is knocked down, the first thing he wants to prove when he gets up to the referee is that he's in good shape. Number one, he wasn't standing on his feet. He was leaning on the ropes. Number two, he couldn't answer me. And number three, his eyes were dead.
Thank you very much, Randy. And now back to ringside.
All right. Thanks very much, Larry. And thank you for pointing out that the crowd is booing, as there were obviously a fair number within this congregation who did not feel that the bout should have been stopped quite so quickly. Randy Newman with a decisive and clear-headed answer to the questions. He knows exactly why he did what he did.
Well, Newman is a competent referee. In fact, that he must have saw something in Williams that we didn't apparently see. But from the outside looking in, it appeared that Williams got up and was able to compose himself. But then again, I think it's left up to the referee.
And now we go back to Larry Merchant in the ring, I believe, with the champion. Go, Larry.
All right. Once again, Mike, the interview has to be longer than the fight. I'm sorry about that. What happened from your point of view? Did you see him really dazed?
Well, no. I noticed my trainers were telling me we were slipping and hooking. So when we slip, because usually I come in, I slip, and I get in there, and that's the hardest part, getting in there, and I never threw the punch. And so we're practicing, and you slip, so you're in there, instantaneously, bing, throw the punch. And I did. I was successful.
What? Were you surprised that he stayed on top of you as much as he did, that he didn't try to move?
Well, I loved it. I loved it. I just knew it took a matter of time. I loved it.
So you knew that as soon as he was doing that, you were going to get a clean shot sooner or later.
Exactly. And my punches were accurate and pinpoint. And I knew eventually I was going to get him.
He has a reputation for getting hit with left hooks. Were you looking for that opening?
No. I was very confident. I wanted to catch him with a good right hand. Believe my right hand is my favorite punch, but I never catch anyone with it. You know, it's my best punch, and I always hit guys with left hook.
All right, we're going to try to take a look at the...
Where's the monitor?
At the monitor, if we can find it, so that we can determine what happened.
Champion, non-pro.
All right. Okay, it was a clean left hook. Did you... I mean, you sparred with him years ago. We know that it didn't mean anything. Were you surprised that he went so fast?
Well, no. I knew if I catch someone clean, they'll go, regardless who they are. Mm-hmm. But you know what I mean? When the referee he hit him with a shot, it looked like he was able to get up. But I guess the referee called what he saw, because I didn't think he was hurt that bad. But I know I hit him with a clean shot.
Speculate for me. How long would it have taken you to get him down a second time if the fight went on?
Oh, no problem. I'd have been all over him. Maybe it's better that the referee did stop early. I would have been all over him. That's when I'm most dangerously, when I know I have someone hurt.
For the record, Mike, I don't know if you know it, this fight went a couple of seconds longer than the Sphinx fight. So far in this building, in the last 13 months, you've fought about one round and two fights.
Well, it's good. I like coming in this building. I like being here. And Donald Trump, he don't play around. He paid that money up. And for this fight, Don told me if I knock him out, he'll pay me $100,000. And I'm looking forward to that $100,000.
Who? Don is going to pay for you?
Don King, yeah. $100,000 for a knockout.
All right, we all want to be there when that happens.
When is this going to happen?
Right, in the post-press conference.
You like it to me? Oh, yes. My church can use some of that money. Yes.
All right.
Henry J. Payton, Holy Trinity Baptist Church.
No doubt.
All right, now let's talk. You've talked about being in control of your career. Tell us what you think is next. Who is next?
Well, I'm just taking it one step at a time. I'll fight anybody. You know what I mean? I don't discriminate from anybody. I'm the best fighter in the world, and there's no man that
all
can
right.
beat me.
Does this mean that Holyfield is or is not your next opponent?
Well, he's in my future, but I don't think he's in my immediate future. But come on, Holyfield, don't matter. That's kids' play.
So you think that you'll fight Holyfield like early next year, and you may have one or two fights before then?
Most likely, but you know what I mean? If they can discuss our things with their people, we can fight in 2 weeks, 3 weeks. He caught a quick knockout. I got a quick knockout. We both still need to work. We didn't get any work.
All right. Jose Ribalta was one of the fighters being considered for your next opponent, and he had a dreadful outing in a preliminary tonight. Did that eliminate him?
Well, it looks kind of dreary for him, but you never know. If he have a couple more fights and he cleans up his act, he's always a good prospect.
What about Douglas, who looked a little better, if not great, in another preliminary? He's been mentioned as a possible opponent.
I take all comers. I don't duck any man.
Can we assume that Michael Doakes is one of the prospects?
All comers. Come one, come all, because nobody can get close to me. They're not even close. I'm the best fighter in the world.
There's been discussions that today people from Israel have been offering you money to come and fight there. You've been reluctant to go abroad. Do you think that as a world champion, as someone who says, I'm the best man on the planet, that you will start to fight abroad?
Well, eventually we'll do that, you know what I mean? But like you said, I'm not in a hurry to leave my country. You know what I mean? I love my country. I'm not in a hurry to leave anywhere. But you know what I mean? If things are right, I'll fight anyone in any place. In their backyard.
How would you describe right now? You've got a lot of things past you. You've always been able to focus on fighting no matter what the other stuff has gone on in your life. Are you as content as you can be now with the situation that you
have? I want to fight, and destruct the world because I'm the best fighter in the world. Thank you very much, Larry.
Thank you. Jim?
All right, Larry. Thank you, Mike Tyson. Thank you, Larry. And here is the man. The boxing public waits to see Mike Tyson fight, a man who 6 days ago knocked out a pretender from Brazil named Adelson Rodriguez in two rounds and now waits to see when his turn is coming. Evander Holyfield, first things first. How did Mike look to you tonight?
He was impressive. He hit the guy with a good left hook, took him out. He did a job. Well done.
Would you have thought that he could knock Carl Williams out in a minute and 33 seconds?
Well, you know, I felt that, you know, anybody could knock anybody out with a clean shot as well as he delivered. He delivered a good shot right on the button, got him out of there.
In his interview with Larry Merchant, Mike acknowledged that you are not likely to be next on his list. He did not say for sure whether he would fight Jose Ribalta or Buster Douglas or Michael Doakes or any of the other names which are being bandied about, but he seemed to make it pretty clear that he's not going to fight you next. Are you getting impatient?
No, I'm not getting impatient. My time is coming, and I will be ready when my time comes.
When will you fight again?
Well, it all depends on how long is the wait. If the wait is 6 months or so, then I would take a fight in October.
All right, so Evander Holyfield looks forward to a fight in October. Ray Leonard, your judgment of how long the public is willing to wait and what does tonight's 90-second knockout do to the expectations regarding Tyson Holyfield?
Well, what happens, it creates more and more of an aura and a persona for Mike Tyson, because what's going to happen now is the intrigue is whether or not Evander Holyfield can deal with the Mike Tyson. As far as he's concerned, he can deal with him.
Is there any other fighter in the division who could pose a real test to Mike other than Evander Holyfield?
I think it's a matter of economics and credibility, and Holyfield has that credibility.
All right. Evander Holyfield, we thank you very much for your time. Congratulations on your victory last week. We look forward to someday seeing you in the ring with the undisputed champ. Right now, back up to Larry Merchant for more from the ring. Larry?
Okay, I'm with Carl Williams and with his trainer, Carmen Graciano. Carl, starting from the beginning, why were you as aggressive as you were, which preceded the knockout.
Well, I wouldn't call it a knockout. I wasn't knocked out. I mean, he knocked me down. The referee stopped the fight. I don't know why. I think politics is involved in all of that. I think they're just setting up the Holyfield fight. Now, I wasn't even hurt.
Did you understand what the referee's question, when he says he
my
said...
My hand was up. Yeah. My hands was up. When the referee said it, I put my hands up like this here. I was ready to go. He just said, I don't know. You know, I don't know what the hell happened.
All right, you've been knocked down a number of times in your career, and every single time you've gotten up, and in some occasions you've fought better. From your experience, shouldn't you have assured the referee, look, I'm okay, let's go?
Well, I think it was an inexperienced referee. This was his first championship fight. When he seen me down the first time, obviously, he just said, okay, it's over. I think he said something to the effect, are you all right? So I immediately put my hands up, and what happened? He stopped the fight. I don't know what's going on. I know it's political. Because I wasn't hurt. I've been down many a times. I've been down 2-3 times in a fight and have gotten up and knocked the opponent out. So I know it was political. I'm not even hurt. You know, I feel bad for not even being able, doing anything. I didn't even really, you know, I didn't even get a chance to show my stuff.
Talking about showing your stuff, explain to us why you felt it was necessary to go to Mike Tyson. He says that when he saw you coming to him and fighting him that way, he was elated.
Well, it wasn't that. It wasn't the fact that I was just coming to him. I didn't feel that I should lay back. You see, with Mike, you have to show Mike that you're not going anywhere. You know what I mean? Okay, he caught me with a good shot. Okay, fine, no problem. I've been caught with good punches before. That's not the problem. And I've been down before. I've been there before. So why did the referee just prematurely stop the fight like that? I've been in that predicament before and have got up and knocked people out and have won, you know?
Carl, you've stated your case eloquently. Thank you. Now back to ringside.
All right, thank you very much, Larry. A very animated, quite disappointed Carl Williams. Lucid, obviously clear-headed. Any further reflections on the judgment to stop the fight based on having seen Carl there, Ray?
Well, now he seems to be pretty clear-headed, and he understood that he was knocked down. In fact, he made mention that he's been knocked down a number of times throughout his career. He was able to get up and actually knock his opponent out. And I think that's going to be debatable from here on out. And that's reason we have referees.
Should a referee keep in mind the history of the individual fighter, the fact that Carl Williams has gotten up from knockdowns to win as opposed to some other fighters who deteriorate after knockdowns?
I think some history or some knowledge of the fighter should be known, because like Aaron Pryor get knocked down and get back up and be incredibly impressive. So I think it's a matter of knowing the fighter.
All right, Mike Tyson, regardless of what you think of the stoppage, continues to perfect the art of the 90-second knockout in Atlantic City. And right now we get ready, Ray, to look at the entire 93 seconds one more time. We said at the beginning of the bout that Williams was susceptible to the left hook. You pointed out that he elected to stand in close with Mike and punch during the first minute of the bout.
Well, he did pretty well. As a matter of fact, he established the left jab, and he kept Mike Tyson at bay. If anything, he didn't allow Mike to get too many punches off in the first round. But what happened when he dropped that right hand, that's when it was all over.
This was an energetic Williams as he attempted to get ready to use the jab to good effect. Tyson always opens with a firestorm. You'll recall that he knocked Frank Bruno down during the first 15 seconds of the bout, which it eventually took him 5 rounds to wrap up. Referee Randy Newman was aggressive from the start, warning Williams early not to hold Tyson while hitting him.
As you watch him, he drop his right hand. Williams throw the left jab. He has the tendency to drop that right hand, which the left hook of Mike Tyson will accommodate that.
And when you say drop the right hand, it's not a big drop. It's almost imperceptible, but it's very important in boxing technique.
Well, it leaves you open for the left hook. And when the fighter, when you place a fighter with the power and the left hook of Mike Tyson, that right hand should be glued to your chin. And I'm sure... As you watch Carl Williams, he's really dazed here, and he's working his way to get out.
So that was that, and Tyson once again etches his name onto the list of shortest heavyweight title bouts in history. The 91-second knockout of Spinks was the fourth shortest in the history of the genre, and now the 93-second knockout of Williams becomes the fifth shortest heavyweight title bout of all time. So Mike
now accounts for 40% of the shortest heavyweight title bouts of all time. And one more time, we are all together. Larry Merchant, Randy Newman was quite unequivocal in defending his stoppage of the bout. Carl Williams was quite unequivocal in denouncing it. What's your reflection on that particular stoppage?
Well, one, the picture showed that he hadn't put up his hands as he claimed he had. I think he was hurt, but I also think that Randy could have let it go on, given the fact of his record, which he is accurate about. Referee should know this is a guy who's been knocked down early and often and has gotten up and fought back. I doubt that he would have survived the first round if that happened, but I think he deserved the opportunity. I think the referee acted a little too precipitously.
Which brings me to the next point, Ray Leonard, and we get ready for your closing comments here. How long will the public put up with this? Does this create increasing fascination with Tyson's knockout power, his ability to put away opponents in 90 seconds, or will there be on the part of the boxing public increasing doubt and disgust with these short, non-competitive bouts?
Well, unfortunately, it's not Tyson's fault that he has such power and devastation in both hands. The fact of the matter is, he's the best in the business. He tells you right away he's the toughest guy on the planet, and he proves it each and every time.
Must he fight Holyfield next to maintain credibility?
Mike Tyson has credibility. He's proven himself. He's unified the heavyweight division. I think that would be an attractive fight, and that's something that some of the fight fans look forward to.
Larry Merchant, your closing comments on Tyson Carl Williams.
Well, there's nothing much to say. What happened in the ring, says it for Mike Tyson. My feeling is that what a fighter is as dominant as he is, there are very few other fighters who can compete with him. But he is such an extraordinary fighter that it's almost, in a sense, like a great artist who has too many paintings on the market, and it drives the market value of the individual paintings down, so that he has to perhaps fight some fewer fights. As far as Holyfield is concerned, I think there's just a kind of negotiating dance going on now. The fight is going to happen. There may be a fight between now and then. Hopefully it would be Michael Doakes, who would be the most credible opponent out there, I think, before such a fight. I've been struck watching Mike all week that he doesn't seem to have fun at these events anymore. That's the overriding feeling I get about Mike Tyson, that he's still a little gun-shy because of everything that's happened in the past. His answers have usually been very cryptic and short with the press. He hasn't enjoyed the scene as much as he used to. And that's a shame for a 23-year-old kid who has everything in the world in his chosen profession. But we sure noticed tonight that once he did it, he was effusive. He was happy. This ring is still the safest place in the world for Mike Tyson. It's where he speaks the best, both with his fists and now with his mouth as well.
Which brings us to the final piece, excuse me, Larry, of historical perspective. He's barely 23 years old. He's been in the ring 37 times as a professional. He's won every time. The record, which has danced in the dreams of heavyweights for 30 years now, is Rocky Marciano's 49-0, 49 fights without a defeat. Mike Tyson has said recently that record doesn't mean anything to him. Clearly, though, if he continues to fight at the rate of every few months for the next few years and continues to win, that record will become increasingly important in the minds of boxing fans as they and we continue to chart Mike Tyson's path through heavyweight boxing history. So now, stay tuned immediately following tonight's World Championship Boxing telecast for a special presentation of One Night Stand, Bob Nelson. That'll be followed by the Kids in the Hall on the East Coast and Young Guns on the West Coast. All of those programs will be seen in their entirety. And be sure to join us for our next telecast of World Championship Boxing as the IBF middleweight champion Michael Nunn defends his title against former middleweight champion Iran Barkley. That's coming your way on Monday, August 14 at 10 o'clock Eastern, 7 o'clock Pacific time, right here on HBO. So now, for Sugar Ray Leonard and Larry Merchant, I'm Tim Lampley saying so long from Atlantic City, New Jersey. The executive producer of HBO Sports and producer of tonight's telecast is Ross Greenberg.
Tyson Williams, directed by Mark Pates. The replay producer was Michael J. Whalen. Feature producers Rick Bernstein and David Harmon. The associate director was Steve Salvatore. Assistants to the producer Brian McDonald and Kendall Reed. The production manager was Russ Gabe. And the technical manager, George Wenzel.
Adventure seeker on an empty street. Just an Eddie Cleaver light on his feet. The young fighter squealing with no time for doubt. With the pain and anger, can't see a way out. It ain't much time asking. I heard him say, gotta find me a future, move out of my way. I want it all, I want it all, I want it all, and I want it now. I want it all, I want it all, I want it all, and I want it now. Listen, all you people, come gather round. I gotta give me a game plan, gotta shake it to the ground. Just give me what I know.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.